kit yet in a blue folder, feel free to grab one. It has both the resolution 24-115, which is the introduction of the transfer of the land in Kailua, and then also Bill 12 from last year's budget hearing, which actually allocates about $20 million for infrastructure improvement for DHHL. So today we'll have Vice Chair Kia Aina speaking, followed by Director Watson from DHHL, and then followed by Council Chair Tommy Waters, and our lovely community member Corbett Kalama will be also available. Following the Corbett's remarks, our community members, community leaders here are available for interview as well. Other than that, we will get started. Once when I see. Once again, thank you guys for coming out today. And at this point in time, I'll introduce Vice Chair Kia Aina.
Aloha and good morning. This morning, Chair Waters and I introduced a resolution to the City Council that will allow for the transfer of 10 acres of residentially zoned lands located in Kalaheo Hillside in Kailua to the State Department of Hawaiian Homelands to develop single-family homes for Hawaiian homeland beneficiaries that will be consistent with the character and scale of the current homes in the area. Our proposal represents a historic opportunity for the City and County of Honolulu to establish the first ever Hawaiian homelands in Kailua and to honor Prince Jonah Kuhio Kalanianaʻole, who was not only instrumental in the establishment of the Hawaiian homelands program, but was also pivotal in the establishment of the City and County of Honolulu and Hawaii's other counties. Through this city land transfer, we hope to address the critical need for housing on Oahu while also helping our Native Hawaiian community. Kailua is a place rich in culture, history, landscapes, and mo'olelo. Establishing a Hawaiian homestead in Kailua will ensure that Native Hawaiians will be able to continue to live and thrive in this special place. The Honolulu City Council is committed to furthering the intent of the Hawaiian Homes Commission Act of 1920. In 2021, I introduced a resolution which commemorated the 100th anniversary of the act and affirmed the city's commitment and role in providing Native Hawaiians with homesteads. In 2023, the Honolulu City Council also approved $20 million of capital improvement project funding for affordable housing infrastructure development, which placed a priority for sites identified for housing development by the Department of Hawaiian Homelands. Today's announcement marks another pivotal moment in the Council's commitment to Native Hawaiians and strengthening its partnership with the state to create more affordable and multi-generational housing for Kamaʻaina. On a personal note, the Hawaiian Homelands program is very dear to me, because without it, I likely would not be standing before you today. Like the majority of Native Hawaiians who now live in the continental United States because of the high cost of living in Hawaii, including housing, my great-grandmother was one of the first beneficiaries to be awarded a Hawaiian homestead lot in Kalamaʻula, Molokai. So as a fourth generation Hawaiian homelands beneficiary, with seven generations of my family growing up on Hawaiian homelands throughout Hawaii, I am blessed to be able to live in a home. That is why I am particularly passionate about ensuring about the success of this program for our Hawaiian community and ensuring that the federal and state governments fulfill their obligations under the Hawaiian Homes Commission Act, which the state agreed to administer as a condition of statehood. The counties, including the City and County of Honolulu, also have a role to play, and the transfer of this city land would further that kuleana. Mahalo.
At this time, I'd like to welcome Director Watson up to say a few words.
Good morning. I'd like to, first of all, thank Esther for putting this together, as well as Chair Tommy Waters in supporting, as well as Mayor Blangiardi for also publicly supporting what we're talking about here today. As we all know, the program historically has been very, very challenged. Most of our inventory of lands are in very isolated areas, very expensive, not as desirable. And I think with this particular project that's being proposed, we're very, very excited in a sense of creating not only a new homestead community, but more than that, addressing the wait list. Unfortunately, a lot of people on our wait lists are dying. So I think it's very timely that not only with the legislature providing $600 million, but the counties, in this case, the city and county of Honolulu, being active in moving our program forward. So we look forward to working with the county, not only on this project, but many more. Mahalo.
At this time, I'd like to welcome Chair Waters.
Hello, everyone. Thank you all for being here, especially everyone standing behind me. I also want to say aloha to all our friends from Kailua and ILWU who are present, and really, you guys should be standing right here behind us as well. This is historic. Never before has the city and county of Honolulu participated in building Hawaiian homes, right? So we're transferring 10 acres of residentially zoned property to DHHL. And that is wonderful. Affordable housing has been a priority for this council and this administration. And everybody asks, so what can we do? We don't want to be in the position of building houses ourselves, the city and county. But what we can do is provide land. Yeah? That's where government can come in. We can provide land and perhaps at a later date the infrastructure needed to build affordable housing. As Kali Watson said, and by the way, thank you, brother. This is awesome
working
with us. This is what we can do, right? Provide the property, because that's the most expensive part of building affordable housing, is the property, right? It's $1.1 million in Honolulu is the median price for a home. That's ridiculous, right? So this is one small step that we can make to achieve the goal of more affordable housing. And it's real personal for me, folks. I'm the fifth of six kids. All my siblings, I'm part Hawaiian too, not a beneficiary, but part Hawaiian too. But all my family live on the mainland, every one of them. You know how sad it is during Thanksgiving and Christmas, right? But how wonderful would it be if we can build more affordable housing so our kids have opportunity to own here in Hawaii. And that's why we're doing this, guys. That's really why we're doing it. And we're looking for more opportunities to partner with Hawaiian Homes and with other agencies to build more affordable housing. So thank you. Thank you guys for being here. Thank you, Esther. This is all you, really. You know, Esther has been a wonderful advocate for affordable housing and Hawaiians. So we put the two together, and we're really proud of this. So thank you, and thank you all for being here.
Now we would like to welcome Corporate Kalama.
Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the gift of life. Firsthand, just mahalo to all of you folks in the room. You know, we live in a special place. We live in Hawaii. We embrace the culture. It impacts all of us in our different walks of life and the different things that we do. So we start from the right place. We start with a place of aloha and values. I have to also compliment Councilwoman Kia. And I've known her for a long time, one of the most knowledgeable people that I've ever worked with. I've worked with her in Washington, D.C., always an advocate for those that don't have a voice. And so when she had talked to me about this a number of years ago, I was thinking, that'd be terrific. You know, growing up in Kailua, playing basketball with Kali's brother at Kailua Park, growing up in a family of 11 kids, a 900-square-foot home, both Native Hawaiians, my parents, Charles Kalama and Elizabeth Kaiakawa-Ilani Kalama, Hula Kumu. We never owned a home. My dad, I remember the time when we got the offer to move on Hawaiian Homelands. We didn't qualify. We had 11 kids. And so we grew up in a 900-square-foot home. But it never stopped the fire burning in all of us to want to own a home. And as progress took place. Many of the Hawaiian families that lived on Kailua, on Kailua Beach and everything where we were, many of those homes were being turned into park through eminent domain and a number of different things and developers, but the people that were being displaced were the Native Hawaiians. It brought the, kept the community together from a cultural standpoint, always very welcoming to us. And when you look at where the project's proposed, it's really special for me. I get goosebumps thinking about it, because when you think back in old Hawaii, from Kauai Nui in the mountain there to Kauhau, the end of Lanikai, that was one of the most heavily farmed and populated places in all of Hawaii. And it's talked about, and it's really full circle now for us to be able to go back there and have the, an opportunity to have a Hawaiian community there. Because it's to me, it's just the right thing to do. But even more so, it's the community there in the Kalio community was built in 1953, post-war housing. It's a community of collaboration and that has gone through a lot of change too. But again, with respect to the what the city's taking this big steps on, and Kali's just been a strong advocate for many years. This is his second time that he's taken on his responsibility and being the chair of the Department of Hawaiian Homelands, being very innovative, very supported by all of us. And I just think it's a great opportunity when you think about it for families to have an opportunity to build generational wealth. But more important for many of the Hawaiian families is having a home and a place that you can call home provides stability. And as a child, that was one probably the most motivating factor for me and my brothers and sisters growing up, was that we're going to own a home someday, because we realized that it was a place that you could come home to and you could raise generations. So as I look at many of the folks that are in the room, a lot of my nephews out there that have been working real hard in the different trades and everything, and the way the city council has been approaching how to address our housing needs in Hawaii, this is a huge step for all of us. I just say mahalo in behalf of the generations to come, for all the kupuna that didn't have an opportunity. So, mahalo, you folks. Aloha.
So at this time, we'll be taking some questions.
Can I ask Mr. Watson a question?
Sure.
Sir, you know, you touched on a really important point about, you know, trying to address the waitlist for Native Hawaiians to get the properties that they so rightfully deserve. How will this impact the waitlist for those who, you know, have been waiting for so long to get something and own a home and call themselves homeowners?
Yeah, what we do is, for this particular site involving 10 acres, we're doing our due diligence as to how many units we can put on the site. That will be consistent with the neighborhood. We don't intend to, increase the density, so it's kind of a traffic issue and what have you. But the main point is we want to, and we appreciate this GIF, which is going to be used to take people off the wait list. We are not looking at doing multi-units or anything like that. It's going to be single family, consistent with the neighborhood. And to whatever extent we can build, those are coming off the wait list.
So that's to be determined, I guess.
That's going
to
be. Yeah, we have to take a look at the infrastructure costs. Drainage is an issue, so we have to address that. We've got to make sure that it doesn't adversely affect the surrounding community. Traffic is also an issue, so we have to design it where the traffic flow is consistent and acceptable for the neighborhood situation.
If I could ask a follow-up question. Okay, I don't want to hold cheese here, but you know, Hawaiian News Now is running a special called Price Out of Paradise, and it really addresses that mass exodus of Native Hawaiians, as well as others, leaving Hawaii to live in the Ninth Island and other parts of the United States. So in this regard here, this will obviously address maybe the exodus of those leaving Hawaii that want to stay here.
Yeah, obviously the cost of housing is a big factor, forcing, I think, people to leave. I think with the addition of this property at no cost to the department, obviously it reduces the net costs for a house. The infrastructure, typically the department covers that cost. So the vertical construction is what needs to be covered by the homesteaders coming off the wait list. So with these other costs being covered, we can make the houses a lot more affordable, attractive, and more importantly, people can qualify. We're also expanding it where we're using other approaches to get the cost even further down, whether it's through a LIHTC or low-income housing tax credit with the option to purchase. We've moving forward on that to address those in the 60% AMI and below. We're also working with Habitat for Humanity so people can put their sweat equity in to get the costs down. We're also looking at owner-builder, where we just provide the finished lots and the homesteader builds his home. So this variety of approaches is the The bottom line is we're trying to avoid bypassing anybody on our wait list, and more importantly, addressing the people on the continent. We want them to come back to Hawaii because there's a lot that can contribute to the improvement and support of the community as a whole.
Do we have any other questions, or?
I guess it would be more about timeline, how quick are you guys hoping to have this done?
Yeah, the timeline, obviously we have a lot of due diligence we have to do. We have to do the design, we have to figure out and fit the number of units consistent with the neighborhood. We also have to look at the infrastructure. We might have to do some environmental assessment, which I think is very clear that's needed in order to address some of the issues regarding traffic, whether it's any environmental issues on site. We have to design. That takes a while. And then the permitting, we're trying to we're trying to adjust that to move that along so as the process is a lot quicker than being delayed by certain other problems with the other departments. So the timeline, I'd say at least a couple years off. I mean, it's not going to be overnight.
And I guess it sounds like it's just land. So what kind of infrastructure are you talking about having to do?
Yeah, there's some, there's an area that's a sloped area to a major extent. So we have to address the slope. So whether we tier it or, put a large retaining wall, that has to be addressed. There's access, there's very limited access, so we have to address whether we need to put two access points on site. All of these issues we have to address and take a look at.
Any other questions at this time? If not, thank you guys for coming out today. We do have our community members, council chair and vice chair, available for interviews as well. Thank you guys.
Thank you.